we were talking about the adjustment factors. Okay, and in the end, we looked at the equations for calculating free flow speed of multi-lane highways and freeways. So today I'm going to start with the two examples of about calculating the free flow speed on multi-lane highways and freeways. And then we will move on to the other analysis as well. Okay, so in this example, you can see one column is for freeways, the other one is for multi-lane highways. Okay, and number of lanes are given, lane width, data clearance on the right-hand side, alignment, okay, base free flow speed, ramp density, access point density. The items which are required for the free flow speed calculations are given here. Okay, now to calculate the calculating the free flow speed of the freeway, the equation is this. So 0.84 is in the power. Okay, so we need lane width adjustment factor, lateral clearance adjustment factor. So FLW is the lane width adjustment factor. Lane width is given as 12 feet. So 12 for 12 feet, the factor is 0. For lateral clearance, this is the table, but we need to know number of lanes and the lateral clearance on the right hand side. 6-lane freeway. So whenever the number of lanes are given, they are given for both directions. Both directions. So in one direction, there will be 3 lanes. In one direction, there will be 3 lanes. Okay. And the right hand side lateral clearance is 4 feet. 4 feet. Okay. So 3 lanes in one direction. Right hand side lateral clearance 4 feet, the factor is 0.8. And total ramp density given 4 ramps per mile. Okay, so give me the free flow speed for the freeway here. Yes, go ahead.
64.3.
Okay, now coming to the multi-lane highway. The free flow speed is calculated as this. I need the base free flow speed is given here, 65 miles per hour. Lane width adjustment factor, I need the lane width 11 feet. I go to this table. The vector is 1.9. Then lateral clearance. I need to know the total lateral clearance now. Total, right plus left. Okay. Now the lateral clearance on the right hand side is given 2 feet. 2 feet. Okay. And it is given, it is an undivided Maltean highway. Undivided Maltean highway. So for an undivided Maltean highway, I told you what should we take as a lateral clearance on the left hand side. I need total. So right hand side is given, left hand side is required. So what should I take as a lateral clearance on the left hand side? If it is undivided highway,
six.
Yeah, it is taken as 6 feet. Okay. Six. The total lateral clearance will be 8 feet. 2 plus 6. Okay, 2 plus 6. So it's a four lane highway. Okay. 8 feet lateral clearance, 6 plus 2. So this one, the factor is 0.9. Okay. Then I need the factor for median type undivided. So the factor is 1.6. Okay. Then I need access points per mile. They are given as 20. 20 access points per mile, the factor is 5. Okay. Give me the free flow speed.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so this is how you calculate the free flow speed if you do not know, if you cannot measure it in the field. Okay, if you cannot measure in the field, then you can use this procedure. Okay, moving on. Using the highway capacity manual procedures or using the concepts of level of service and capacity, we can perform three types of analysis on the road. We can perform operational analysis, service flow rate and service volume analysis, and design analysis. All of them require level of service calculations and the related concepts. Okay, start with the operational analysis. This is what you are supposed to do in your project as well. Okay, in your project, you are supposed to do operational analysis of the highway, meaning finding out the level of service, finding out the level of service. Operational analysis means that you have existing traffic, roadway and control conditions, and you are trying to find out what will be the level of service under these conditions, or what is the level of service, expected level of service under these conditions. Okay, so we need the existing traffic, roadway and control conditions, and we are trying to find out under these conditions, what is the expected level of service? This is known as operational analysis. So we need two things for this analysis: free flow speed, which we have already talked about earlier, and we need the flow rate. We need the flow rate in passenger cars per mile, per hour per lane. We need the flow rate in passenger cars per hour per lane. Okay. So the volume which you will get from the field will be in vehicles per hour. Okay, it will be in vehicles per hour. You need to convert it to passenger cars per hour per day. Okay, how do you do it? So V is the volume you get from the field, and VP is the flow rate in passenger cars per hour per day. Okay, so you divide V with PHF, peak hour factor, it will be converted to flow rate. Then you divide by N, number of lanes, it will be converted to per lane. And then you divide by FHV, which is heavy vehicle adjustment factor. FHV is heavy vehicle adjustment factor. So it will be converted from vehicles per hour to passenger cars per hour. Okay. So you need the volume from the field, and you need these three things to convert the volume to flow rate in passenger cars per hour. Okay. Then we have service flow rate and service volume analysis. In service flow rate and service volume analysis, we are trying to find out what will be the maximum service flow rate that you can have on this highway to maintain a specific level of service under the given conditions. Under the given conditions on a particular roadway, what maximum flow rate I can have on this highway to maintain the required level of service. Okay, so SFI means the service flow rate for level of service I. So in these equations, wherever you see the subscript I, that means it is referring to a specific level of service. So I will be replaced by the level of service which you are investigating. So it can be A, B, C, D, E. Okay. So level of service for service flow rate for level of service I. This is MSF. MSF is maximum service flow rate, which is a service flow rate under ideal conditions. Maximum service flow rate meaning service flow rate under ideal conditions, again for level of service I. And then I already told you N and FHV, number of lanes and heavy vehicle adjustment factor. This is service flow rate. If you want to convert service flow rate to service volume, you will multiply by peak hour factor. Okay. So using this analysis, you can know if I want to maintain a level of service I on the highway, what should be the flow rate and what should be the volume under the conditions of the road. Okay, so you have traffic and control and roadway conditions, what will be the level of service. Okay, then the third type of analysis is design analysis. In design analysis, you are trying to find out how many lanes should be provided for a highway for its future volume to maintain a specific level of service. So now you are designing a highway for future volume and you want to find out how many lanes should I provide to maintain the specific level of service. Okay. So in this equation again, N, number of lanes you require for I level of service. DDHV is directional design hourly volume. Directional design hourly volume, the future volume. Okay. Then peak hour factor, maximum service flow rate, and heavy vehicle adjustment factor. So in all the three analyses, you have seen the use of heavy vehicle adjustment factor. Heavy vehicle adjustment factor is required in all the analysis. Okay, now let us see what is this factor and how we can calculate it. The equation for calculating this factor is on the right hand side of the slide. So in the equation, you can see two things, PHV and EHV. PHV is percentage of heavy vehicles. EHV is equivalency factor for heavy vehicles. So you need two things. You need percentage of heavy vehicles and equivalency factor for heavy vehicles. Percentage of heavy vehicles, so you must know what do we mean by heavy vehicle. Any vehicle which has more than four tires touching the pavement surface is a heavy vehicle. Any vehicle which has more than four tires touching the pavement surface is a heavy vehicle. Okay, so the tire, the fifth tire, the spare tire in your trunk doesn't count. Okay, you cannot say my car is a heavy vehicle, I have five tires. No, your fifth tire is on the trunk. No, put it on the ground, then it will become a heavy vehicle. There are two types of heavy vehicles, SUT meaning single unit trucks and TT which is trailer trucks. SUT single unit trucks, TT trailer trucks. Okay. Single unit truck is basically a smaller truck. You must have seen the trucks which come for garbage collection, to pick up the garbage from the dustbins. These are single unit trucks. Okay, and trailer trucks are longer. Okay, they have a trailer attached with the back, at the back, and you can see them on the causeway. You can see them on the causeway. Okay, if you go towards that highway, you will see them, especially at night. And what is EHV? EHV is known as passenger car equivalency factor as well. Passenger car equivalency factor, what does it mean? This is the factor which gives you the replacement of a truck in terms of passenger cars in the traffic stream. The replacement of a truck in terms of passenger car in a traffic stream. Let me rephrase it. How many passenger cars can replace this particular truck in the traffic stream in terms of space? If I remove this truck from the traffic stream, how many cars can fit in its place in the traffic stream? Okay, so it depends upon the size of the truck, obviously. It also depends upon the gradient of the road, okay, the terrain of the road. Why? Because heavy vehicles or trucks become slower in difficult terrain conditions. So if you have rolling terrain or if you have gradients, heavy, high gradients, then trucks will become much slower. and then when they become slower, they are basically occupying more space because other cars are moving away from them. Okay, so because of this, they have more, their equivalency factor will be higher. In that case, their equivalency factor will be higher. Okay, so for getting the value of the equivalency factor, as I said, you must know the composition of the trucks and you must know the terrain conditions. Let us talk about the terrain conditions, and I will talk about the composition of the trucks as well. So terrain conditions are generally of two types: general terrain and gradient. General terrain and gradient. Okay. Then within general terrain, we have two subtypes: level and rolling. Within general terrain, we have two subtypes: level and rolling. Okay. How do I know that it is general terrain or gradient? For general terrain, you can see in the first sentence here, in the first point here, two conditions are given. If you meet any of these two conditions, it's a general terrain condition. If you meet any of these two points, any of the criteria mentioned here, it's a general terrain surface. Okay. What are these two criteria? The first criteria is we have gradient more than 3% and length less than 0.25 miles. Gradient more than 3%, length less than 0.25 miles. It's a general terrain condition. Either you call it level or rolling. The second criteria is we have gradient less than 3% and length less than 0.5 miles. Gradient less than 3%, length less than 0.5 miles. Again, it's general terrain condition. Okay. So if you meet any of these criteria, it's a general terrain. Then within general terrain, we have level and rolling. Level means gradient is less than 2%. Level means gradient is less than 2%. Okay. And rolling means that the gradient is more than 2%, right? The gradient is more than 2%. So you're meeting the criteria from the first two points, and then you have gradient more than 2%. Now, in rolling terrain conditions, the truck may slow down up to a crawling speed. What is the crawling speed? The minimum speed that a truck can maintain on a gradient or on any segment of the highway. Crawling speed, you must have when you are standing in a queue on a congested highway. So vehicles are moving very slowly, right? You are trying to fill up the gap here and there. So that is your crawling speed. That is the crawling speed. So trucks on rolling terrain, on a steep gradient, they go on a crawling speed. Okay. So if you don't have general terrain conditions, then you can find out the equivalency factor for gradient conditions from this table or the next one. Okay, so there are two tables here. So in this table, you need the value of the gradient, the length of the gradient, and the percentage of heavy vehicles. Okay, this, the first column is for the value of the gradient. Then we have the length of the gradient, and then we have the percentage of heavy vehicles in the top row here. Okay. Now you can see these gradients are all positive. For negative gradient, we have this, the first row. Okay. Negative gradient has the first row. Now negative means what? Upward or downward? Negative gradient means what? Upward or downward?
Downward.
Huh?
Downward.
Downward. Yes, downward. Okay. Now in this table, we are considering single unit trucks to be 70% and trailer trucks to be 30%. Single unit trucks 70%, trailer trucks 30% for use of this table. Okay. This is also known as standard mix and default mix or light mix. Okay. All these names are given to the names are given to the same condition: 70% single unit trucks, 30% trailer trucks. Okay. So you will use it if you have this composition, then you will use this table. Okay. Then if you have any other composition. So there are two other possible compositions. One is known as equal mix, 50% single unit trucks, 50% trailer trucks. Okay. The other one is known as heavy mix, which is 30% single unit trucks and 70% trailer trucks. Okay. Then you will get the value from here. Okay. And again, you need the same factors, the value of the gradient, the percentage of trucks, and the length of the gradient. Okay. Now let us look at how we can calculate or how we can convert the vehicles per hour into passenger cars per hour. The volume into from vehicles per hour to passenger cars per hour. Okay, so we have a couple of examples here. Okay, so a freeway has rolling terrain. It has a traffic composition, 12% trucks, 3% RVs. Now, in the new manual, they consider all of them under the same category. Okay, so you don't have to worry about why they are mentioning RVs separately. Okay, you in the tables, you can use 15% trucks in the equation, 15%, okay, this is fine. You come here, see, all of them are included. Trucks, buses, RVs, all of them included. Okay, so you don't have to worry about what should we do with this 3%. You add them, you add it. Okay, just add it together and then you will see the composition. Okay. So 12% truck, 3% RV means 15% heavy vehicles. 15% heavy vehicles. Rolling terrain volume is 3200 vehicles per hour, and the equivalent volume can be, you have to calculate in passenger cars per hour. In passenger cars per hour. Okay, so there are two methods to do it. I will explain you both the methods. Okay, so the first method is by using the heavy vehicle adjustment factor. So this is an equation for heavy vehicle adjustment factor. Okay, so I need a percentage of trucks. This is 1 minus, sorry, EHV minus. Okay, the equivalency factor for heavy vehicle in rolling terrain is 3. Okay, so 3 minus 1. How much is this value?
Zero point seven seven.
Okay, now if you want equivalent volume in passenger cars per hour, then you take the volume which is given in vehicles per hour, 3200 divided by the equivalency factor. How much is it?
Four one five six.
Now it is passenger cars per hour. Okay. In the other method, we will use the percentage and the equivalency factor directly. Okay. So first of all, we will calculate the number of trucks, number of heavy vehicles. Okay. So out of 3,200, 15% are heavy vehicles. 3,200 into 15%, how much is it? Okay, these are heavy vehicles. Okay, then if you want the equivalent volume, then I will multiply with the equivalency factor. Okay, so 480 multiply by 3. How much?
1440.
Sorry, 1,400?
Yes, 1440.
1440. Okay. Now this is passenger cars now. These are now passenger cars. Okay. So if you want total equivalent volume, it will be 1440 plus the percentage which you already have. Sorry, the percent the passenger cars which you already have. So from 3,200, 15% were trucks, remaining were passenger cars, right? So 3,200, remaining will be 0.85. So how much is this?
Four one six zero
passenger cars per hour. Okay, so you can see both answers are close to each other. This one and this one, they are very close to each other. So both methods are correct. If you just want to convert vehicles per hour to passenger cars per hour, you can go with any of these methods. Okay. Okay, then we have another case where one section may not have a constant gradient, especially freeway sections are very long. Okay, so in long sections, it may happen that the highway does not have a constant gradient. Okay, in that case, you may have two or three values. For example, if you see here on the slide here, they are mentioning two gradients for the same segment. So there's a freeway segment or a highway segment which has two gradients. Now you want to calculate the heavy vehicle adjustment factor for this segment. You can calculate a different value for each gradient and do the analysis for each one separately. Obviously it will increase your work. You are, instead of doing one analysis, now you are doing two sets of analysis. Or you can combine them into a single value. You can combine these gradients into a single value as well. Okay. The method of combining them is known as average gradient method. Average gradient method. Average gradient method says that the combined gradient for a segment is total rise or fall divided by total length. Okay. Total rise or fall means the total difference in elevation created by these gradients. Rise or fall, okay. Rise means they are going up, down. Fall means they are going down. Okay, so total rise or fall created by these gradients and divided by the total length of the segment. So for example, 3% has a length of 3000 feet. So if you want to calculate, and it is upgrade. See, both gradients are mentioned as upgrade, okay. So 3000 length and 3% gradient. So the rise will be 0.03 into 3000. Gradient into length will give you the rise, right? Gradient into the length. Plus 5% upward gradient, again, so it will be a rise, and 5000 length. So 0.05 into 5000. Divide by total length, which is 5000 plus 3000, meaning 8000. Okay, so what is the average gradient here?
Zero point zero four two five.
Okay, or you can say 4.25%. Okay, so if this segment doesn't meet the general terrain conditions and you have to use the gradient, then you will not use 3% or 5%, you will use 4.25%. Okay. Okay, and then there are some more examples here. Okay, so these are like given with three gradients now. This one is given with three gradients now, but you will use the same approach. Okay, so if you are calculating total rise, okay, it will be 2000 into 3% plus 1000 into 2% and 900 into 4%. Okay, you add them together, divide by the total length, which is 2000 plus 1000 plus 900, and you get the total number. Okay, so you divide them and you will get the average gradient. Okay, so the remaining are, then after this we have some more numericals which require more time, so I will start them on Monday, inshallah. Okay, so So if you have any questions, you can ask me. Okay, otherwise I'm going.